Hi everyone, Aaron here for zollotech, and this is the 16-inch M1 Max MacBook Pro. This has been my main device over the past week. In fact, all of the different videos on this channel from the past week since I unboxed this and set it up have been fully edited on this device. And so I have some thoughts about it, the good and the bad, I wanted to share with you since I've been using it over that amount of time. Now, most of it's good, but before we get started, the first thing is, Apple did not send me a review unit. In fact, I bought this with my own money. It's not a sponsored video or anything like that. And this is one of the more expensive models as well. Now, I bought this with the intent of replacing my Mac Pro that has an Intel CPU in it, as the M1 seems to work much better for me for the type of footage that I'm filming with these videos. H.265 and other things, it just seems to go through it really quickly. So I went with the M1 Max, and it's got a 10-core CPU, a 32-core GPU, 64 gigs of RAM, as well as a 4 terabyte solid state drive. So it's pretty high end. It doesn't have the 8 terabyte option that you can opt up to. So it's around $4,500 to $4,800 plus tax. So it's a really expensive machine, but this is with the intent of replacing my main Mac Pro as my main editing device. So not only can I connect this to a monitor, which I normally do, a Pro Display XDR, now I can bring it on the go, have a similar monitor with me as well. So I'm really impressed with it overall. Of course, you can go with lower end models. There's a 14-inch model as well, 14-inch, 16-inch, and then M1 Pro or M1 Max. So we'll talk about all the things that are good and bad after I've been using it for a week. We'll start with the bad things and then move on to the good. So the first bad thing really isn't a huge deal for me, but will be for some, and that's the notch. And the notch doesn't really bother me at all, other than the fact that it has some odd behaviors with the mouse. When you move your mouse up to the top of the notch, it goes behind the notch. In some applications, it goes around the notch. And I think this is something that some people will have to sort of program to change, or maybe Apple has it already there in the framework of macOS Monterey, but they need to do something to make this more of a consistent experience. In some cases, it goes behind the notch. Other cases, it sort of snaps between them, and others, it goes around them. So right now, I think Apple needs to fix that. That's the only thing that bothers me, is the inconsistencies with it. One of the other things I'm not crazy about is the webcam. Now, it's great that it's there, but it's still only 1080p. Now, it's better if you're doing conferencing calls and things like that, but for me, it's not something that I think, when I have this high end of a MacBook, I'm using 4K cameras, I've been using them forever. Why can't we have at least the quality of, say, an iPad Pro camera in here with center stage that follows me around? Center stage will follow me around as I move. It's similar to having a cameraman behind the MacBook and following you as you move around the room, or maybe you just shift off axis a little bit. It will follow you. Something the MacBook doesn't have, which doesn't make a lot of sense to me. So that's something that I was a little disappointed with. The camera's fine for different things. So if we open up maybe QuickTime and record from it, I'll show you what I mean. If I go to movie recording, I'll make sure it's in the highest quality here. Let's make sure we're on maximum. We'll hit record. And now we're recording from the webcam. So you'll see it's fine for things like conference calls. One thing I am impressed with, though, is the microphones on here. So that's more of a good thing with this MacBook. These microphones are even better than before. I'm not sure they're as good as the iMac, but they're as good as any other MacBook or better, and as good as the iPad. So you could use this to record in a pinch on the go if you don't have a microphone with you. These will definitely work. But the webcam is a little bit disappointing unless you're in 1080p, but if you usually look at 4K footage, it's not going to look great. It looks better than before, but it's still a little bit of a letdown for me. I would have loved to at least have center stage so it follows me around. Now, another thing that's not really a negative, it's great that they added it, but it seems a little dated, is the SD card slot. Now, it's great to have, and a lot of cameras still use this, and I'm sure there's a huge need for this. However, newer cameras, such as the ones I'm recording with, use CF Express Type A or Type B or something else. So not having the ability to maybe have CF Express Type A also, since that seems to be the way things are going, is a little bit of a frustration for me, because I still have to use a memory card reader. So I'm used to that. That's not a huge deal, but SD is nice when I'm in a pinch, but they're much slower than what we have with CF Express Type A or Type B. Those sorts of cards are just so much faster that I've gotten used to the transfer speeds when you're offloading a lot of footage. For most people, it will be absolutely fine. Most people will really like the SD card. So it's not a big deal. It's just something I noticed that I really wish we had. It was maybe a different format, or maybe two different formats. That would be something I would like to see, but I'm not really complaining that they've brought it back. Also, we have HDMI. It's a port I'll probably never use, but if you present a lot, of course, that's going to be great. And then, of course, your Thunderbolt ports around the outside edge. So if you haven't seen this, we also have MagSafe. And it's a little odd this year. If you want the fastest charging on the MacBook Pro 16-inch, you need MagSafe, which will bump it up to about 50% in 30 minutes, which is very impressive for the big battery that's close to 100 watt hours or milliamp hours rather. And you can also charge through USB-C, but you only get the fast charging through MagSafe. So you can use either or, and you can also charge back through USB-C to another Mac or to an iPhone or things like that. So it will work in reverse if you need to do that. Maybe you're running low on another friend's MacBook and you have extra battery here. You can plug it in, although it's not going to be fast charging the other Mac or anything like that. So those are really my only negatives about it, and it's not much of a negative, but the good thing about this is, well, let's start with the design. I love that they made it thicker again. When it was thinner, it's fine, but now you're taking away from things that, well, pros use, or people more pro than me for sure, want the HDMI port, you want the SD card slot, you want all of the extra features, and when you make it thinner and thinner, you're just compromising too much and taking away things that we have to add on later to plug in. So it's a great thing that they've made this design. It reminds me a little bit of older MacBooks. Of course, you've got the 4 feet on the bottom and MacBook Pro in it, and you don't have a light up logo. That doesn't really bother me. I've kind of gotten used to that. But right now, I think it's a great design. It feels very heavy. It is a heavy device, but it's something I don't mind because it does the job I need it to do, and it does it really, really well. The next thing is the display. This display is, well, literally like having a Pro Display XDR on the go. So now I have a 16-inch or 16.2-inch Pro Display XDR that goes up to 1600 nits brightness if I need to edit HDR content or watch HDR content, and it just looks incredible. In fact, I'd say it looks better than the Pro Display XDR. It has great viewing angles. It is a little bit reflective, but that's typical of a glossy display anyway, but it looks great. It goes super bright. You can see everything you need to see, and it just looks amazing. You've got contoured corners at the upper edge. I like that. And then it's squared off at the bottom. So at the menu, it's got those contoured corners. I don't mind it at all. I think it's a nice look, and I'm really, really happy with the display. Also, I'm happy that they brought the keyboard back to where we have function keys at the top. I really don't like the touch bar. I found that I often would type and then hit the touch bar and change a setting. Or I'd have to look down, hunt for that setting, change it, then look back up. I found it to be more of a distraction than more useful. I don't like the touch bar. I know some people do, but it's gone for now. Touch ID is here though, and that's nice to have. I do wish we had Face ID, but we have Touch ID. And of course, the speakers are nice and loud. They're super loud. In fact, let me play a clip for you so you can hear it if you didn't hear my sample before. So let's go into here. So we'll just hit play on this, and you can listen. That's half volume, so this goes crazy loud. Let me turn it all the way up, although you probably will hear it distorted. The speakers sound great. They sound better than the 14-inch MacBook, and they just have an amazing amount of bass for something this small. Of course, it's not going to be like studio monitors, but this is more than sufficient enough to edit video on the go. You're going to hear what it's sounding like, and it's probably going to sound better than what most people's speakers sound like anyway, unless they have high-end headphones or studio monitors. So they really sound very good, and no problems there. Now, as far as the speed, well, editing on this is unlike editing even on my Mac Pro. Now, of course, I'm doing a lot of video editing, but when I'm editing through a timeline, it's just crazy fast all the time. So if I go into Final Cut Pro, wait for it here. So if we open Final Cut Pro, this is my AirPods comparison that I did earlier, and this is just as fluid as can be, more fluid than what I had on the Mac Pro. The Mac Pro was super fast, even with its dual GPUs, but sometimes it would sort of hiccup when playing back with heavy effects on it. Here, I can zip through full resolution, best performance, no problems. In fact, it's fast enough not only to do that, but play games like Cities Skylines at full resolution, something my brother tried on a 14-inch M1 Max version, no problem whatsoever. It just kind of does what you need it to do, and it gets out of your way. This is fast enough to where It's just fast all the time, and now you can just work and you're not kind of waiting for the limitations of the machine. The speed is really what I've been wanting in a laptop for a very long time. The M1 13-inch MacBook Pro was good. This is phenomenal. This is unbelievably fast all the time. And with the speakers and then the display combined, it's literally a Mac Pro on the go with a Pro Display XDR, but it runs on battery. And the battery life is really, really good. In fact, I did some editing this morning. I'm at 100% because it was plugged into a monitor, but the editing on this, I could edit probably two full 15-minute videos on here without the battery going flat after exporting the videos. That's not something I could do on an Intel Mac. Normally, I could maybe get through one. If I got through one, a 15-minute video, you're editing maybe an hour or two of editing at full resolution with Final Cut Pro rendering in the background and things, it usually would bring that battery down really fast. You're not losing any performance on the battery. You don't need to plug it in to get that performance. I can easily edit, export the video, and then be on the go. And it's so fast, like I said before, that when I'm editing a video, when I finish editing, I'll export that video, and then I'll go to sort of edit the thumbnail. By the time I'm done editing the thumbnail, it's already done exporting. That's something I haven't really experienced before. Typically, I have to kind of edit the thumbnail, get all of the description and things ready, then I'll go back to the MacBook, wait for it to finish exporting, and then I can upload it. Now it's just almost always done, whether it's 4K 30, 4K 60 footage. I've even messed around with 8K a little bit. It's incredibly fast and impressive when it comes to that. There's really not too many other downsides other than the notch and maybe the fact that there's no keys that allow me to bring the brightness up or down on the keyboard. You have to do that in the control center. It's not a huge deal, but it is something that I wish was on the keyboard itself and not up in a menu somewhere. That's probably my only annoyance with it whatsoever. I don't mind really anything about it. It's exactly what I've wanted for years from a MacBook, and it's only going to get better with whatever the Mac Pro is that they have coming out and maybe iMac Pro later on. Now that's been my experience over the past week, but I'd love to hear from you if there's something that you use regularly. Of course, I'm not doing 3D modeling and I'm not doing CAD on this really or anything like that. But if there's some tests you want to see specifically, I'd love to run them for you and just get back to with maybe some numbers or do another video. If you have any questions, I'd love to hear from you in the comments below. But over the past week, this has really exceeded my expectations as far as what MacBooks can do. And I'll definitely be using this as my main machine for the time being. So unless something better comes out, this is what I'm going to be editing every single video on. In fact, like I said, the display is so good, it's like the Pro Display XDR on the go, and it's what I'll be using for everything. Again, if you have any other questions, let me know in the comments below. And if you haven't subscribed already, please subscribe. And if you enjoyed the video, please give it a like. As always, thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.